I mean, the Calvinists say God forces you to be a believer, right? Calvinists, God makes you a believer. The Arminians say you decide to believe, but in common there is belief. So they will both agree that he saves those, but not...
That's perfect.
That verse doesn't
say
exclusively.
I just wrote that in my margin. Yeah. It's not exclusively a believer.
It's not exclusively.
Especially
yes,
a believer.
Especially a believer, which means that he also saves unbelievers.
That's right.
Now, that is the most radical teaching you're going to hear on Christian airwaves, that God saves unbelievers.
Yep.
Listen to what we're saying. God saves unbelievers.
How does he save them, Martin?
By giving them belief.
Because, and on what basis?
On what basis? That's a good question.
What's the basis of
saving them? What's the Calvinist basis of giving them belief? He just picks them randomly, right?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the Arminian basis of belief?
They pick themselves.
They pick them. They have to be somehow worthy or smart to pick. What's the basis of our teaching of belief?
It's that God chooses.
Right. So we agree with the Calvinists, but we go the extra mile and say that he's eventually going to give belief to everyone. That's the key.
And the reason he does it is because the work of his son.
That's
was effective.
The work of the
Look
cross.
Look at the cross
That's
of
right.
Calvary, friends. Look at the cross of Calvary. Tell me that what all the suffering he went through was not enough. Tell me that all his suffering, his pain, his sweating, as it were, great drops of blood, all the agony that Jesus Christ went through on that cross, and you tell me that it wasn't enough.
That's what
tell
they say.
Tell me it's not enough.
That's what they say.
I dare you to tell me that.
I know.
It's almost a slap in the face.
Almost.
It is enough.
It is a slap in the face.
I was trying to be cordial.
Yeah, for the once in your life. Here's these three views in a nutshell. The Calvinist God has the ability and the power to save all mankind, but refuses to do so. The Arminian God would like to save all mankind, but does not have the power and ability to do so. Our God, the God that Sheridan and I teach, and that many, many people are hearing of this God today. They're finding it in the scriptures, taking the God who can and will. This God has the power. Listen to me. I'm preaching the gospel. This God has the power and the ability and the desire to save all mankind and will do so in the fullness of times. 1 Timothy 2:6. That in the fullness of times he will reconcile all to himself.
For even as in Adam all are dying, thus also in Christ shall all be vivified. It doesn't say those who are in Christ. It says as in Adam all are dying, thus also in Christ shall all be vivified. Notice the word Christ, his title, his office, what he does.
And he is the Savior of all mankind, especially of believers, which means that those who have faith now have something more.
That's right. And that's what Paul goes on in verse 23 in 1 Corinthians 15, yet each in his own class, the first fruit, Christ, thereupon those who are Christ in his presence.
And we're not robbing you of your specialness.
That's a special salvation.
Yes, special. I think that's a good word to use, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And I think people are afraid we're robbing them of the specialness.
Yeah.
Don't I get something for believing that? Well, actually, you do.
Yeah.
You are special.
If you're a believer today,
it's miraculous.
Guess what you get?
You win the big prize.
Christ is coming.
Tell them what they've won.
Here's what they won. And what's behind door number three? And here's what they won. They win the fact that because of faith in Christ, there's coming of, well, first of all, you're justified, you're holy in Christ.
All that going on today.
You got in a celestial
transported into the kingdom of the Son of his love.
And the next step for you is you're going to meet the Lord in the air.
And then you will be ever with the Lord.
And he's going to snatch us away to celestial glories, and we're going to live and be with Christ in our celestial realm for the next two eons, the millennial kingdom and the new heavens and new earth. That's our special salvation.
That's pretty good. And you have that if you believe today.
And an unbeliever doesn't get
that. An unbeliever doesn't
have
that. He's
dead. He's dead during that time.
Dead.
He is destroyed. And then at the great white throne, he stands before God, and he's cast in the lake of fire, which is
the second death. What happens then?
And then at the end of that period called the new heavens and new earth, he's going to abolish death.
Christ will abolish death.
Christ, and that means all those in a lake of fire
will come out of the lake of fire, justified.
Be justified and vivified because he will abolish the last enemy.
So you see how much sense 1 Timothy 4:10 makes. Look at this. Not even the King James Version can screw up this verse. God is the Savior of all mankind, especially of believers. That one word especially throws a wrench into your doctrine if you're in church. It throws a complete wrench in it. How do you explain it? He's the Savior of all mankind. Well, that's just believers. Well, especially a believer. That screws everything up.
But Martin, if you teach this, people will think they can sin all they want, and they're going to, it's going to, it's necessary. You know what actually you know what Clarence Larkin says? Clarence Larkin's a great dispensational Baptist. And he says there is a moral reason for hell because it restrains men from sin.
Oh, it does, huh?
Yes.
Oh, it does? It restrains people from sin. The Christian world has been teaching this hellfire and brimstone for thousands of years, and what's it done for the world? Yeah, people are falling over themselves to go to Christ, aren't they?
Yeah,
this hell doctrine, it works like crazy, man. Where do I get a bottle of that stuff? Look
By
at
the
it.
Way,
look what it's done.
If you went to Christ because you're trying to escape hell, you're probably not a believer because you're not believing good news.
That's right.
You're believing bad news. If the only reason you're religious or you go to church,
fire insurance,
is because of fire insurance, you're not a believer.
No.
You have not trusted Christ. You're just looking for a fire escape, and it's a false teaching. You're believing a lie. But if you believe that Christ died for your sins, he was entombed and roused again the third day, we preach good news, not bad
That's
news.
An evangel, what Christ has done for you. Exactly right. Exactly right.
The gospel is concerning God's Son, not eternal torment. The gospel is concerning God's Son, not what you do or your accomplishments. Time goes fast.
And he is
the
Savior of all mankind, especially of believers. Think about that word especially. Please, think about that word especially.
Hey, by the way, get a concordant version.
Yeah.
And look up every reference to this word especially. Everyone, that's a homework assignment. And if you do it, call me and let me know. 847-312-4676.
Hey.
Do that, Simon.
Hey, tomorrow, let's start with that. Let's go over those especially verses tomorrow. That's your homework assignment, Sheridan. I'm Martin Zender. We'll be here tomorrow. I trust you'll be with us.